Good morning. I'm going to talk to you about sonic signatures in music mixing. The whole idea for my study came to me last year when I was doing the mixing module of my master's degree here at the University of West London. We were analyzing creative practice of mixing engineers, established mixing engineers, and I realized that all of these guys had a distinctive sound that we could break down and analyze as researchers to see what were the elements that influenced this sonic identity. And I'm an aspiring mixing engineer, and as such, I would like to have a distinctive sound, because for the most part, that's how the industry decides who, you know, picks who to use for a particular project. I also realized that we were studying mixing practice retrospectively, so through the vast catalog of work that these guys have, you know, have achieved through the years. And so I thought, wouldn't it be good to have a system to consciously develop a sonic signature right from the start? And that set out the premise for my study, which looks at defining signatures in music mixing and coming up with a system to create one. So I'm going to take you through the mind map of my study, which basically serves as an overview of the project. We're going to look at the research aspect, which deals with defining the concept of sonic signatures, and that's particularly in music mixing, as that highlights the need for study of the project. And then we're going to move on to the practical side of it, which is where I break down the system that I've developed to create the sonic signature. So looking at the research aspect, in trying to actually define what sonic signatures are in mixing, the literature doesn't really seem to point to a single definitive answer as to what they are, because they are there's a lot of factors that are responsible for the creation of signatures. And so what I was able to do is divide them into categories based on the sort of most common factor for their existence. And the categories I have here are equipment, places, people, and business. The idea with this taxonomy of sonic signatures is that they exist through a combination of all of these aspects put together. Basically, everything that happens throughout the recording process and everyone who's involved in it leaves an audible trace. And if we apply that to mixing, just to give some quick examples, for example, using a particular type of studio monitors will give a coloration to the final mix. And being in a control room means that, you know, no matter how that control room has been treated, there will still be an audible trace, or rather, we will be influenced by the sound of the control room in the way we hear our mixes. And if we look at the business category, things like client revisions or revisions from labels, for example, that still will have an impact on the final sound. It's like almost like an external other signature that comes into it. I've left out the people category because that leads me onto another set of factors, which, you know, mostly the creative collaboration factor. Basically, anyone, like the recording process is a collaborative one by nature. So anyone who's involved in the recording process at any stage can leave a signature. Now, mixing engineers step into it at the penultimate stage in this process. So we could maybe argue that a mixing engineer adds maybe a fresher, more distinguishable signature because it comes towards the end of the process, but they do need to take into consideration who's been there before and what's already been established. And a last consideration is style. So genres in music have certain things that are considered stylistic conventions that need to be followed in order to make sure that we're following the tropes of that genre. And for mixing engineers, it's the same thing. It's just important for them to follow these stylistic conventions to be able to create mixes that can be considered authentic. And so what the research is showing is that there are a number of factors that I've called external factors that influence the imprint of this sonic signature. And to these factors, I'd like to add some that I consider internal. So aesthetic vision, professional, personal background, and training. And particularly the training aspect is important here because that's what I've used to then go and create my own sonic signature. And I'm going to take you through that now. So this is where we bring in the practical element of the project. And what I'm proposing, so the model I'm proposing, follows a practice-based approach, and which it resembles what I've called a modern apprenticeship method. Now, what I mean by that is that traditionally, mixing engineers would acquire their skills through following their mentors, or shadowing their mentors in the studio. And now that doesn't really happen so much anymore. So what I'm proposing here is that this now happens or can happen online. So utilizing videos of mixing practice through channels such as Mix with the Masters or Pure Mix, where established engineers do show their workflow and their techniques. And it's quite important to choose the mentors carefully because there are so many videos available. And so the criteria that I've chosen to do this is genre and setup. So choose mentors that work in a similar style of music as the mixer and also that follow a similar setup. Now in the case of my particular project, my genre niche is country pop music and the setup is ITB, so in the box mixing. So these are the engineers that I've chosen for my study based on those criteria. I've conducted an analysis of the video tutorials with these engineers where they break down some of their sessions, and I've come up with a set of concepts and sort of workflows, techniques, and things to basically then test in my own practical phase, so in my own creative practice. And I'm going to show these results with this table. Basically, you have the engineers at the top and then the processes that have been analyzed on the side. Now, this is a slightly simplified version of the table for the purposes of this presentation, but the idea with it is to just present a blueprint for mix analysis and basically show this sort of concept of modern apprenticeship method. So still learning from mentors, but just doing it, breaking down the online video tutorials rather than being present in the studio, which also means that you can learn from more than one mentor at the same time. I'm going to play a couple of reference tracks that I've used in my videos, just so you guys hear sort of what the material was. Now I've got empty many bottles filling both our trays. I'm getting drunk on a plane. Fine drinks for everybody, but the pilot, it's a party. Got the 737 rocking like a G6. Stewardess is some sexy lead and poured a Coke and whiskey. Told her about my condition, got a little mile high flight attention. It's Mardi Gras up in the clouds. I'm up so high, may never come. Never had nothing handed to him on a silver platter. It's hard to be a good man, good son, do something good that matters. Okay, and so the next step was to actually then implement the practical phase of the project. So I went and conducted, I produced 16 test mixes, which four per engineer, which were aimed at testing out those concepts that we saw in the video analysis. And I filmed my sessions and I kept a journal whilst mixing just to make sure I could later go and analyze the videos and just come up, re-evaluate the concept of the sessions and see what worked and what didn't work. And so to present the results from my own mix analysis and bringing back the table from before, but this time I've highlighted in green the concepts that did work out and that I've welcomed in my practice, and hid in gray the ones that didn't quite work out. for this presentation, I'm not really too interested in going into the specifics of what worked and what didn't work, because that applies to my own personal practice. I'm really more interested in showing the kind of analysis that I've done and the system that you know I've developed to create a signature. I'm also now going to play a couple of my final mixes. And basically, just before I do that, the last step of the practical process was to take the 16 test mixes, go back and do another set of mixes. So basically come up with 10 final mixes where I've taken all of these concepts. So basically what I've learned from my mentors, what worked out for me, and so where I've expanded on my training. Also taking into consideration the stylistic implication of mixing in country pop music, and taking into consideration all those factors, external and internal factors that I've mentioned earlier. Now that quite neatly forms the basis of my sonic signature. And so now I'll play these mixes, which hopefully show these developing elements.
Drive all night waiting for a sign that may not ever come. I was born with a restless heart and a fever in my lungs. Trouble's done, it's work on.
We've now come full circle on the initial mind map of my study, which with just one final concept to go through, and that's the idea of developing a template, so a mixed template. So what I've been able to do throughout this process is to come up with my own mixing template, which for in the box mixing really sort of forms the basis of the signature, because it holds information on the mixer's preferred workflow, their preferred equipment, and just generally their mixing aesthetic. So now I have something that provides me with a tangible account of my signature, and that's what I'm gonna keep developing as this study progresses, as my career progresses, and just generally as the sonic signature evolves, because to me there's no such thing as a definitive sonic signature. There's only one that is relevant to one's current practice and current situation, because if we take into consideration the aspects we were saying earlier, like the external factors, if someone changes a piece of equipment in their studio, if they change their studio, or just anything, genre, workflow, anything else that influences a signature, obviously that signature will evolve. And so we should be open to that. And like, you know, I'd just like to be able to know, be aware of what my sound is currently, and just be open for it to develop further. So thank you very much for listening. I'll be happy to answer any questions.